Hello everyone, welcome back to Road to Living Water, where I, Isaac Curtis, try to teach you what I know as a Christian in hopes that it encourages you to do the same. So first off, by the time I'm recording this, the first video came out last week. And I want to say thank you all for the support and the encouragement for the series. It really is low-key terrifying to be doing this, so I appreciate the comments and stuff. Also, second thing, I do have a script this time. I have a monitor right here with like some stuff on it. I finally decided to make a script in case I lose my train of thought or something, like I do all the time in our gaming channel.
I gotta tell this story because my ADHD is trying to hold me back. Where was I going with that? Where was I? Okay, this all ties in together, I promise.
So today we're looking at chapter 3 of Max Lucado's He Still Moves Stones, which is titled, Don't Miss the Party, The Dungeon of the Bitter. The chapter starts off with referencing the parable about the prodigal son, which, spoiler alert, is about a son who takes off with his inheritance and goes off to live a wild life, only to crash down and come back to his father. The father, instead of being angry, celebrates that his son is home. What a lot of people forget is that there is another son in the parable, who was older and more obedient. At the end of the parable, the older son is pouting because he never got a party thrown for him, and he was the one who was more obedient. Instead, it's given to the son who ran away and came back home. So Luke 15:25-32 says, Meanwhile, the older son was in the fields working. When he returned home, he heard music and dancing in the house, and he asked one of his servants what was going on. Your brother is back, he was told, and your father has killed the calf we were fattening and has prepared a great feast. We are celebrating because of his safe return. The older brother was angry and wouldn't go in. His father came out and begged him, but he replied, All these years I've worked hard for you and never once refused to do a single thing you told me to do. In all that time, you never gave me even one young goat for a feast with my friends. Yet this son of yours comes back after squandering your money on prostitutes. You celebrate by killing the finest calf we have. His father said to him, Look, dear son, you and I are very close, and everything I have is yours. We had to celebrate this happy day, for your brother was dead and has come back to life. He was lost, but now he is found. So there's a whole moral in that story about, you know, Jesus leaves the 99 to get the one who was left behind. You know how that whole theme is, but that's for another video. What Lucado does is he goes on to elaborate on the older son's side of the story, the moral of that side. He connects it all by telling a story of his own childhood. He said when he was in fourth grade, he got a completely unexpected gift at a Christmas party, but it wasn't unexpected in a good way. He was actually pretty disappointed. He wanted a toy pistol called a sixth finger, when in the end, he had gotten a Western stationery. If you don't know what a stationery is, it's like office supplies, pretty much. So as you can imagine, he was pretty disappointed. So disappointed, in fact, that he pouted for the entire party. But what's interesting is the way he worded it. He said, I was upset, so I missed the party. I was present, but I pouted. He connects this back with the parable by saying the older son pouted at the party too. He focused so much on the negative that he missed the miracle that was right in front of him. Obviously, I could just make this video the lesson, oh, just be more positive, because it sounds that simple, but I'd kind of like to dive deeper than that. This past week, I heard a sermon at a church called Life Point, where the pastor, Sean, talked about God's unconditional love. He said when he had planned for the sermon, he really wanted to skip it because of how simple it sounded. The reality was, the only reason the message sounded so simple is because we can't comprehend something like God's unconditional love. In the end, he elaborated more on it and ended up making a super great encouraging sermon. So Sean, if you're watching this, you did great making a whole sermon out of a simple lesson. So even though the theme of this chapter is to not pout and be negative and miss out on the joys of life, I want to explain that in a way that could be more relatable. So later in the chapter, Max talks about bitterness and what it can do to a person. He describes it as a deep, dark dungeon, but you're the one who has control of whether you enter it or not. He says, you can choose, like many, to chain yourself to the hurt. This is something I can relate to a lot. I'm sure some of you have dealt with this too. When something bad happens, you're left jaded. That one or many things that haunt your life can dictate your everyday decisions. You get so caught up in reliving your hurt over and over that you can't see life without it, thus only focusing on the bad. I'm someone who overthinks a ton, so when something happens, I'll think about it for days or even weeks at a time. And it's especially bad when I need to get something done on, let's say, a Tuesday. And then next thing you know, it's Friday and I still haven't gotten that thing done because I was focusing so much on the bad thing. But as hard as it is to see, you have a choice with that. And I'm not saying like if you're depressed, it's like, oh, then just be happier. Because I'm well aware it does not work like that. You can give your bitterness and your hurt to God. Lucado says God deals with a bitter heart by reminding you of what you have is more important than what you don't have. You still have your relationship with God. No one can take or even touch it. He says it's definitely not easy to realize that. And then gives an example of someone who did. He starts talking about a time Abraham Lincoln was giving a speech. He held a cane in one hand hand and a hat in the other. As the people were done clapping, he had no idea what to do with the hat before starting the speech. He couldn't put it on the podium because it was too big. The floor wasn't an option because it was too dirty. Suddenly, a man stepped forward, took the hat, and then returned to his seat. Lucado then reveals that this man was a great friend to Lincoln. He was one of his strongest supporters during the early stages of his presidency. What's interesting, though, apparently this man and Lincoln both ran for office and even had debates, which were more popular than their friendship. Who was this man, you might ask? Stephen A. Douglas. Lucado says, but on Lincoln's finest day, Douglas set aside their differences and held the hat of the president. He was, in a way, present at the party. Even though he must have been disappointed about losing the race, he still looked past it. This is gonna sound really cheesy, but this is what I came up with. When you look past your past, you have more opportunities to bear fruit. And I don't mean to suppress all your negative thoughts. It's very hard to explain, and I apologize if I'm wording it weird, but Lucado says, wise are we if we rise above our hurts. For if we do, we'll be present at the Father's final celebration, a party to end all parties, a party where no powders will be permitted. Why don't you come and join the fun? Craig Groeschel, a pastor I found online during quarantine, and who actually started the domino effect of me coming back to Christ, once said, we have a kingdom to advance. The context was talking about spiritual warfare and stuff, but I think it can go well with this situation too. That quote sticks with me because it's encouraging. We have a calling to be like Christ, but how can we do that if we are voluntarily chained by our own guilt? Jesus took that guilt with him when he died on the cross for you and I. You don't have to live in constant fear or anger over the mistakes you've made or your hurt. You can give it to God. Talk about it with him or something. I promise you it works. Again, I don't mean like, oh, just never be upset. It's not like a switch that can just be turned on in an instant. Good things can take time, but also a whole lot of effort. I mean, it took me literal months to get where I'm at right now spiritually. It's been almost a whole year since I've started climbing back up the hill. But if God is on your side, you are absolutely sure to get there. The choice is always yours to make. And that pretty much sums up this chapter. Hope you all understood it. Because for this video, since I got a script, I wrote down most of my thoughts instead of like reading or quoting entire paragraphs of the book. So that's it for this video. Thank you all for watching. Like, comment, subscribe. Check out my two other channels, Odd Party for if you want to have a laugh at two idiots playing video games, or Horror Highway if you, I don't know, want to be scared. But hope you all have a great day. Let me know what I can pray about for you, and I will see you all in the next video.